So let's pass to the next presentation, that is by Jacopo Agucci, that is a researcher in the functioning and vulnerability of marine ecosystem group of the Renewable Marine Resource Department of the Institute of Ciences del Mar of CSIC in Barcelona, Spain. And he's going to present the work entitled Marine Robotic Developments Toward the Monitoring of Fish Stocks. Okay, Jacopo.
Good morning, everyone. Thanks for having me here. I'm sharing the presentation. Do you see it?
Yeah.
Okay. So I belong to the marine.
Excuse me, we don't see the presentation. We see the PowerPoint.
Yeah, you can put it in full screen.
Press it's already right. Full screen.
No, but no, maybe you share the applications, the window instead of the entire screen.
So let me, because I'm unfamiliar with him, I will share it again. Sorry.
Okay.
It's screen shared. I have only desktop window. Is that possible?
No, better to share the entire screen so we are sure we see your presentation.
Yeah, but I don't know how to do it.
You should have in the menu, in this menu where it says...
I have screen share and the only option I have is desktop window.
Okay.
Put them, okay.
Sorry, my apologies.
No problem.
entire screen, sorry, here. Entire screen. Okay, is that good? Do you see me? Hello?
Yeah, now it's fine.
Okay.
Okay, that's perfect.
Now you change it again.
Okay. Yeah, it's good now. It's full screen.
Yeah, now. Okay.
Okay. Sorry. The title of this talk is Marine Robotic Developments Toward the Monitoring of Fish Stocks. And the first things I would like to point out is that the trawling is a fishery-dependent method for stock assessment. Basically, what we know about population we exploit in the sea depends from what we collect on nets. But trawling is unethical because we destroy the environment, and temporally too scattered because we have to use vessels. And all vessel-assisted technology imply a high, costly and time logistic effort. So since more than a decade, we decided that a solution for temporal intensive monitoring of ecosystems at all depths of the continental margin may be the use of these novel technologies called multiparametric cable observatories. These are basically benthic platforms connected to shore by Ethernet cable or telecommunication cables that host video cameras, allowing us to open a small window on the continental margin, and we can control the cameras, image acquisition rate, positioning of the optics and so on from our offices. So these are internet-based applications that allow the streaming of the images onto land servers, along with a lot of multiparametric environmental data. So say this, I would like to stress that field of view of those camera is presently poor representative in order to be considered a proxy for the ecological surface of an ecosystem we want to monitor. So over the years, we've been passing to the use of advanced mobile internet-operated vehicles, which are mobile robotic platforms that would move around the cable observatories, widening the data acquisition radius, so the monitoring radius. I'm talking about, for example, the crawlers was one of the funder models is the WALL-E, is installed in the deep sea of Canada, as I will show you later. And this is a multiparametric platform with wheel, video cameras, plus a whole bunch of sensors, chlorophyll, temperature, salinity, methane, and so on. And this tethered to a distant node. So we can cover approximately 200 meters square of radius around an observatory node in the deep sea of Canada. Then we have also the possibility to use advanced biomimicking platforms, which are allowing us to move on uncharted terrain. So texturally complex terrains, where basically the tracked wheels of the crawlers would not be able to advance. And these are types of tests we are trialing now, connecting those platforms to the cable observatories. So, of course, we are going toward a phase in which we are creating in situ robotized marine ecology laboratories for the 4D monitoring. So, meaning that we have a whole bunch of benthic platforms, either fixed or mobile, that are branching off from smart cables, telecommunication or industry cables that wire the seabed. So we have the two dimension of the seabed plus their mooring projections that are towers that climb up the water column, and they have sensor each depth strata, and basically they perform a bentopelagic integrated monitoring, providing the third spatial dimension. Since this data acquisition is synchronously performed by all fixed and mobile platforms, we have a temporal intensive. So at the frequency data acquisition in the frequency of seconds over decades, basically. And what I would like to say is that this is the reason why we call it 4D monitoring. And this monitoring is virtually holistic. We have oceanographic sensors, we have geochemical sensors, and we have the images as representative of the biotic components of the ecosystems. Here you have some examples of the Manso Viator, which is deployed by a boat with a garage. So it's an untethered, no cable version of a crawler. Plus, we are also elaborating other types of crawlers that are garaging or hosted or docked, sorry, to the cable observatories. And these machines acquire petabyte of image informations that we are still processing by hand, basically, by the eyes. So you can imagine the bottom constraint in information processing we have here. So we are performing since few years, thanks to the I'm not a computer scientist, I'm an ecologist, so I am an end user. Thanks to the help of my colleagues in computer science, we are performing since many years some studies at the platform we manage to implement artificial intelligence in animal tracking, classification, counting, and then, as you will see later, to place this type of development into a pipeline for the computing of ecological indicators as biodiversity. So we can start with the first example. This is multi-species monitoring at the OPC. This is the platform I co-manage at the level of ecological studies belonging to the Polytechnic University of Catalunya, Vilanova e la Geltrú, close to Barcelona, 20 meter depth in a Nature 2000 area. This is an example of the platform in front of an artificial reef that protects the platform against illegal trawling. So thanks to Dr. Ennio Taviani, which is present in the audience today here, we are studying the progressive retraining of fish automated detection and classification. Why? Because it is more than 10 years that we acquire images by 30 minutes, continuously by day and by night, and we want to develop a system in near real time or near real time that can produce time series of fish counts. Fish counts as total fishes from one side and fish count for each species. So we have to identify in these frames, time-lapse frames, the fishes, and then we have to classify them. This is an example of the algorithm we are coming up to. If you have more questions, we are using faster RCNN. If you have more specific questions, you can ask to Dr. Ottaviani, which is present, as I told you, with us. And progressive retraining, why? Because basically we train the classifier on, we have 2 years of manually labeled images. So we have Python bounding box, and we attribute the animal into the bounding box to a species as a category. So we can train the CNN to perform the classification. And when we have the classifier trained on 1 month of data, then we replicate the processing for the next 4, 5, 6 months. And we observe that detection are good, but classification get a bit lost, because basically we have a changing in environmental conditions, but fish are still detected anyway. So seasonal cycles vary the light and the turbidity and so on of this shallow coastal ecosystem. But then we have a turnover in the fish assemblage, because some species are going away for the reproductive or molting or growing cycles, and others are coming into the area. So the classifier is not able to. So our idea is to produce an alarm system telling to the platform manager when it is the time to retrain the system to detect automatically the fishes. So another, the second example I would like to show is a stocks monitoring for sable fish in Canada. We are participating, I am a former science team leader for the ecological development of the Ocean Network Canada. It's the larger infrastructural network of cable observatories in the planet, and we work in Barkley Canyon. Sable fish in the area is heavily fished, is a very important resource for Canada and US, and we have the chance to study the number of fishes we have into a polygon was the corners are made by a set of cameras. So we can synchronize image acquisition in different nodes. And you have the crawlers here, the crawler that I showed you before here. And so we have somehow a way to try to scale up the field of view data of each single camera to the whole monitoring area of the network, which would be important for us because basically imaging may produce ancillary data for fishery independent assessment. So we're not using trawling, which produce data by kilometer square, but we're using field of view of few meter square, but we can statistically interpolate them when they proceed from different time, from different space points, and then we can have possibly more ecologically meaningful population abundances. This is an example of what we're doing. This is a YOLO classification and tracking. We have videos in which we have several frames per second. These videos last a few minutes, and we are aiming to classify only sable fishes, and we track the sable fish displacement over consecutive frames with Euclidean distances in order to avoid recounting. So, which is the scenario in which we are now for the application of artificial intelligence in image processing? This is a picture I draw from another study we had in Lofoten Verlag, so in Bergen, Norway, a cable observatory. We had the problem that in this real-time world context, we have to clean the images. So we apply some CLI rendering images. We perform background subtraction. Then we have enhancing by thresholding. Then we have the classification of the shape of the animals. Then we have time series. Up to this stage, this is very important. We have a visual count in black, for example, here, of the fishes, rock fishes. These are commercial exploited species, plus all the environmental readings we want in a synchronous mode, salinity, temperature, or the variation in the height of the water column given by the tidal cycle in the area. But this is only a first step. So we have an input data bank in which we have a line time series of biological and environmental data. We have these for several observational points, as many cameras as we have into a network, a monitoring network area. So we are studying spatial interpolation procedures to merge the different field of view of the cameras in order to pass from data representative at meter squared to kilometer squared to be compared by trawling. Then if we can pass from counts to density, so from count at different points to a density over a surface, so this is a proxy that is required for stock assessment, we can also possibly use acoustic camera or laser scanning to size the animals producing class size frequency distributions. And when we have class size frequency distribution, we have the number of animal and the biomass and their sizing, and we can calculate biomass. Then we can obtain in relative numbers of species for all the species in an ecosystem, we have evenness or biodiversity. And at this point, we can apply time series analysis and multivariate statistics. Why I'm telling you this? Because the development of artificial intelligence is not only in the first step of this diagram, where I show you the images, but also where I put on the right the script. Meaning that artificial intelligence has to be embedded in the pipeline for the extraction of ecological indicators, because we want also that the end user can visualize in real time the graph and can be advised on the type of analysis they can select on a web page based on data quality, We may have a lot of gaps in data acquisition, sensor malfunctioning. We have blurry images, any type of happening. So I'm concluding where we are now in Spain, because this is more or less a Spanish contextualized meeting. We have been awarded recently by a technological project named PLOM, in which we pretend to create movable networks of standalone units, so lenders that are like cable observatories without cables, and over with camera and few environmental sensors that are deployable into MPAs, which we are creating to protect the stocks of the Norway lobster, okay, and which we would like to use to perform ecological monitoring of this species, plus all the species constituting the Norway lobster community, but also endowing them those platforms of some sort of artificial intelligence in order to track Norway lobster, okay, and to send information into the water column to receiving stations by boat, opportunity vessels, or pop-up buoys. Okay, the important things is that this constellation of fixed benthic stations are somehow connected by autonomous underwater vehicles. And autonomous underwater vehicles are responsible to scale local observations to a larger areas in between stations, because they will also use imaging tools. So with this, I finished. Thank you very much.
SeaCaptor, monitorización electrónica para una mejor gestión.